Started a little late tonight. Sorry about that. So I was in my few seconds before the service thinking about what's up, Lord? What do you want to say tonight? And I feel like the Lord showed me the proverbial fork in the road. And I feel like maybe us personally feel like we're at a fork in the road in our lives. Maybe, you know, we know people in our lives. Praying a lot about our children. The generation of generations has been on my heart a lot. And I think as a body of Christ, we're at a fork in the road. I really feel strongly that we are on the cusp of something that either will be the Lord or it will be more of the same. And sometimes it's hard to know what to do with those forks in the road because sometimes we don't get the lantern by night, right? And the cloud by day, like Moses did, to know which way to go as the children of Israel walked through the desert. But the Lord did promise us that his word is a lamp unto our feet. And when we go to the word, we will always know, right, to follow the peace in our hearts. And the path just becomes clear to us. And sometimes when we don't know where to go, then we just stand, right? And we trust the Lord to know that when we take the next step, he'll guide the way. And so I want to read from Isaiah 59. As for me, this is my covenant or my league with them, says the Lord. My spirit, which is upon you and who writes the law of God inwardly on your heart, and my word, which I have put in your mouth, shall not depart out of your mouth or out of the mouths of your true spiritual children or out of the mouths of your children's children, says the Lord, from henceforth and forever. His word has taken root in our hearts, and he has chosen human habitation as his resting place now. The Holy Spirit abides in us, and his word is powerful. We know that, right? We know that when we speak the word, it has power. But what that tells me is that my words have power, and even if my children's children, you know, their words have power because they're my children, right? They're my descendants. And so have faith, right? Put our trust in the Lord and know that he will lead us and guide us. And I really feel a strong burden to pray for our children, to pray for our children's children, that the Lord will continue to lead and guide them. I feel like the church, I feel like we're just at that fork in the road. I don't know how else to say it. We're at that fork in the road where, you know, we've seen these revivals, we've seen the things that have happened, and we want the Lord to do what he's going to do, and it's going to be a new thing, but we don't know what that new thing is because he's never done it. We don't know how to pray. We don't know what to ask. We don't know what to believe other than, Lord, have your way.
Yes.
And if we continue to be led by the Holy Spirit, if we continue to allow the Holy Spirit to have its way, which is one of the things I think is so special about this house of worship, is that the Holy Spirit conducts the entire service from beginning to end almost every time we come together.
Amen.
And as long as the Holy Spirit has his way, the manifestation will come. The manifestation will come. The manifestation will come. It always comes when the Holy Spirit is given the room, when we have faith to speak out, knowing that it's the Holy Spirit prompting us. You know, it was so exciting on Sunday to see people speaking out. That's the first step, right? That's the first step down the fork in the road, following after the Holy Spirit. And nothing happens by accident. And so I guess, think about it. Think about the fork in the road. Think about and pray about and read the word and find the words that we need to pave the way. I feel like it's going to take all of us. It's going to take every one of us to bring our paving stones, right? You know, we have our all, and this is something I'm working on with the kids downstairs. We all have our different gifts and abilities. We all need to operate in all of the callings of our gifts and our abilities in order to pave the way. You know, otherwise we're playing hopscotch down the road instead of walking down the yellow brick road, which is a silly analogy, but it's this, I mean, that's what the Lord wants us to do. And I've always thought of the body of Christ as a tapestry, right? And if you don't have every thread woven together perfectly, you don't get the full image of what that tapestry is revealing. And I think that that is such an integral way that, you know, we need each other. We need each other. We need to be together. We need to gird each other up. And I just think it's exciting to see what the Lord is doing in this house. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm very happy to be a part of it here. And I'm looking forward to taking the fork in the road with all of you in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Lord. All right, anybody have any prayer requests or testimonies tonight? Roberto. Peter, did you have something to share?
Okay, I've got a couple things. So, as everybody here knows, I've been
was praying for you, Peter, and I can't remember what the Lord told me. It'll come to me. I was praying for you after the service on Sunday before I even realized what was going on. I'll by the end of the service, the Lord will remind me. Praise the Lord. Yeah, Myron.
Yeah, I just, Peter, we'll get together prayer. Because what he was talking about was kind of the same thing that happened today with this wound and everything. I was ready to go back to my old job at Link, and they opened the door and they said, yeah, you might even have your old rough back. And when I got there, my boss said, yeah, put his butt to work. So it was really nice, and then all of a sudden I ended up in the hospital, and his leg and everything. And I'm thinking, and then my phone went dead. So I got back in touch with him again and told him what was going on, and went and had my TV shot done. It was supposed to return last Friday, and Thursday night my leg started bothering me again. So in the midst of all this, the nurse that came over, I have a visiting nurse that comes twice a week and wraps it. And she was talking to me, and she said, I was talking about driving and stuff. And I talked to Sister Shelley here about driving and stuff too. And they're both telling me that I can't drive. I can't drive anymore. And I'm like, no, that's not happening. I need to drive. I need to make some money.
Mm-hmm.
You know. But then the Lord was saying it might be a pride issue where I do need to humble myself before Him and know that He's going to take care of things while I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, amen.
And I got that, and I just said, okay. So this brings me all the way up to today. I went to the doctor's. First time I've seen her, and I wanted to switch doctors, and I thought she's seen me for the past 6 weeks, whatever. And I'm not real happy because it looks like she just came out of med school or whatever. So, and I just thought she was, you know, just throwing medication at me. And anyways, the good nurse that was coming to my place said, no, you have every right to ask for another doctor. So the guy that was filling in for her while she was on vacation while I was in the hospital, I want him. I just thought he did, you know, he's put me on the where I'm at now. And she said to me today, she said, yeah, that's no problem. So I just appreciated that, but the end result was that there was a lot more pink skin inside the womb.
Yeah.
And she said, this looks a lot better today. And I'm like, that's what I wanted to hear.
Yeah,
amen.
You know? So then I asked her too, I said, what do you think? What do you think about driving? He says, well, because your leg's not elevated and it's in one spot all the time, you might be just aggravating it. So I would hold on. So I'm like, okay, all right, Lord. I want to be obedient. So, and I told her, you know, I have to sell the cream, but the main thing was that my pain that I've been living with for the past couple weeks before it was an 8. Then I lived with for like a 5 on the scale, and today it was like down to a 2.
Come on,
thank the Lord.
So I'm like, I know if the pain's gone, there's healing going on.
Amen.
Yes.
So again, I appreciate everybody's prayers. And, so I'd like to ask for prayer too as far as employment.
Amen.
So thank you.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
And I would just ask for prayer for Michael and I, probably more so for Michael. We're trying to prepare our house to sell in Waukee, and we're looking to move to the east side of Des Moines. Only have a few things on the must-have list, and so it's kind of wide open, which almost makes it harder as to where we're going to go because we have no idea. You know, so just need the Lord's wisdom for the right place for us, and wisdom on what to spend time and money on in Waukee before we leave. And favor in the market right now. So,
amen.
And patience for my husband while I send him 5,000 houses a day.
Amen.
Amen. So, anyone else tonight?
All right.
Shh, Roberto. Don't encourage him. It's pigeons. It's pigeons, but no, they're not on the list. It's a really short list, but pigeons are not on the list. All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight. Heavenly Father, we just come before you tonight, and we just thank you, Lord, that when we look to you, Lord, that you will always lead us and guide us into victory, Lord, that you have a purpose and a plan. And you have given us favor, Lord, that we are blessed and highly favored. We are your children, Lord. We are children of the King, Lord. And we thank you that we put our trust and our hope in you, that you will never fail us. You will never disappoint us, Lord. We thank you for the wisdom that you give us to lead us and guide us in job situations. We thank you, Lord, for the healing that needs to come, for depression, for diabetes. We thank you, Lord, that you're encouraging each of us to stir up the gifts within us and to step out in boldness to operate in the fullness of the gifts, Lord. And we thank you for a safe place to come, Lord, that this house of prayer, this house of worship, we thank you that we have a body where we can come together, Lord, and express all of the gifts and callings you have in us, Lord, and that you are lifted up and magnified, Lord, that you are revealed, Lord, that your character, that your nature is revealed in every service, Lord, your love and your mercy and your grace are exalted, Lord, your wisdom, as you encourage each of us through your words of encouragement, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, prophetic words, continue to increase the gifts, Lord. Stir it up within us. Have your way in this house, Holy Spirit. Come and lead us and guide us, Lord, that you are welcome to have your way in this house, Lord. We thank you for our pastor who brings us the word and feeds us the meat of the word of God every time we come together, Lord. We ask you to bless this house, bless this ministry, Lord. Bless every member of this body, Lord. Let us remember that we are blessed and highly favored. Children of the King, chosen for such a time as this, to come and serve and step in, to step in and take our place, Lord, in these last days. We ask you, Lord, quiet the distractions. Quiet the distractions that would turn us to the right or turn us to the left, but to just follow after you. That you will make the way clear, Lord. You will make the path plain before us. When we turn our hearts and our minds and we turn our eyes to you, Lord, that you will never leave us. You will never forsake us, Lord. That you never disappoint, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We praise you tonight. Be magnified, be lifted high in our worship tonight. And let us be transformed by the renewing of our mind, by the word that we receive here tonight. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Healing in the room.
Thank you, Lord. Just a reminder, if you brought your cell phone with you, to either silent it or go ahead and turn it off. And this Friday, Eastern Gate House of Prayer. I just encourage anybody who can to be here. I don't know, Mike, if you have any direction or any vision from the Lord.
What you were talking about is the fork in the road situation. We need to come together. All of us need to come. There'll be some visitors from other venues. Already had responses from the invitations. I see that they're watching us. And even as it was spoken last time here from Brother Rick, that we see from the Eastern Gate what's coming first for this region and stuff. So I'm discerning that people are watching us. And we just need to, like I said, find that correct road. Even when this prayer thing started, it you know, at the beginning of the services and stuff like that, I was very, very hesitant to call it out because it resembled kind of something that we saw in the past, and I didn't want to do it just because it happened that way. But I don't feel bad about releasing that because it has opened a different realm.
And absolutely.
So that was a right move in the fork of the road. It wasn't wrong. That's what I'm seeing. So these are the things that I'm watching, you know. I don't want to change things to change things. I just want to be obedient to the Lord.
Yeah, true.
So.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
This is Friday night. Since Sunday, something's coming up. And it's even going to be in this. It is in this room where we're in tonight.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah. Yeah, Roberto. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Yeah. 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 And what the Lord opens, no man can shut.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. There are new songs in the realm that I feel have been waiting for an opportunity to be released, and I'm pretty excited to see what that's going to be for Friday night.
Yeah, great. I'll make sure we do record so we have a foundation to work with.
Praise the Lord. All right, well, let's speak the word tonight.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?
Lord.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Oh, hang on. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Yes, Lord. The Lord rebukes the tower for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
All right, Michael, you want to come take the offering tonight? You want to ask a blessing? You want me to ask a blessing? Okay. Heavenly Father, we just ask you to bless this offering tonight. Lord, we give from the abundance and from the blessings that flow. We thank you, Lord, that that we cannot outgive you, Lord. And we trust that the offering here tonight will be blessed and multiplied for this ministry, for the furthering of your kingdom, and to bless all those in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. While we're standing, let's pray for... Thank the Lord. I'm going to be as brief as I can be tonight because we've got some stuff going on after we get through here. And so I don't want to keep you any longer than we need to, but yet I want to share something with you this morning, this evening. So if you will, Roberto, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, and we'll read verses 4 through 9. How many of you know that miracles alone are not the answer? Praise the Lord. Miracles are great, and God does miraculous things. There's no question about it. But sometimes what we think of as miracles and what God does miraculously are not necessarily always the same. But God wants us to experience Him in a way that is miraculous, in a way that can not only transform our lives but impact others. I feel like, you know, there's such a struggle for all of us. I mean, I'm not speaking about anybody particular, but you know, the challenges for people today to believe and to trust in the goodness of God and in the grace of God, the love of God. When we know how, you know, just speaking for myself, how inconsistent I can be, and yet how consistent God is. So often, you know, we have a tendency to think of, because of our inconsistencies, it would cause God to be inconsistent. But He is not inconsistent. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the God of love, the God of grace and mercy. And it isn't dependent on us. It's all about Him. And so let's get right to it. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 4 through 9. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything ye are enriched by Him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, so that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Praise the Lord. If look at verse 8 here. Who shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise God. So, how are we going to turn out? Praise the Lord. Do you ever question that? I mean, do you ever think about that yourself? I mean, what do we want to be known for? What are we going to live for? What are we going to die for? When I die, I don't think about dying very much, but the older I get, the more it does kind of creep in the back of your mind, you know, but I don't want to be known for my political persuasion. I saw last night, I don't know, a half hour or so before we went to bed, there was a particular minister that Sally wanted to watch, and we watched it. And it was, I agreed with it, except that it was so political, it kind of disturbed me. And I wasn't, you know, I'm not mad at the guy, and I'm not judging him or anything. It's just like, I just didn't, it just didn't make me feel very good about it. I just, you know what I'm saying? I don't want to be remembered for my particular political stance. I've got political views, and fairly strong ones for that matter. I just don't talk about it a whole lot. But I don't think that's my calling, you know. But I don't want to be remembered for that. I don't want to be remembered for financial success. I've had some success. I've had failures. I wouldn't want that to be the thing that people remembered me by. Oh, what a great businessman, or, you know, how clever he was and how he managed to make things happen and all that kind of stuff. I don't even want to be remembered for my religion.
Come on.
When I die, I'd like to be known as somebody who just knew Jesus. Somebody who enjoyed Jesus.
Yes.
Not trying to cram him down somebody's throat or beat him up or to intimidate him or anything, but just somebody that just had a good time with the Lord, that just enjoyed his presence. Amen. I'd like to be remembered for somebody who loved Jesus.
Yeah.
Not a weird, flaky way, but just somebody who just loved the Lord, you know? I always have to qualify that because I feel awkward. But the problem is, there's nothing within me that can guarantee that I'll continue to follow the Lord in a way that's going to be all that attractive to everybody else. I'm not smart enough. I'm not self-disciplined enough. I'm certainly not holy enough to make it through life without getting distracted by selfishness and sin. Praise the Lord. I'm surprised I didn't hear a real wild amen from back there in the back, but thank you, Sally, for your patience. Praise God. But it's always a risk, praise the Lord. You know, I can try to be faithful to the best of my ability, try to be, you know, loyal to God and do what's right. But the problem is, I know that I'm human, and I know I'll fail. I have failed before, and I'm pretty sure I'll probably fail again. I'm not the first person on this planet to struggle with this.
Come on.
I didn't get an amen there either, but that's all right. Praise the Lord. Anybody that tries to do what's right knows how frustrating it can be to not be able to do it as right as we'd like to do it.
Amen.
You know, we make big promises about how we'll live for God and what we're going to do and how we're going to do it and everything else, and then we find ourselves failing just a few minutes later or a few days later. It's disappointing.
Yep.
But it's disappointing to us, not to God.
Right.
Let's look at this again, John chapter 13, verse 21 through 26. John 13, 21 to 26. When Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit. This is the Last Supper, I think, is the way we all relate to it. But when Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit, and he testified and said, verily, verily, I say unto you that one of you shall betray me. And then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spake. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. Simon Peter therefore beckoned to him that he should ask who it should be of him whom he spake. He then, lying on Jesus' breast, saith unto him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, he it is to whom I shall give a sop, and when I have dipped it, and when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Praise the Lord. So, everybody's eating, and they're all having this meal together, and then Jesus drops the bomb on them. One of you is going to betray me. right? One of you is going to rat me out. Now remember, just a few hours earlier, all of the disciples promised that they would stay faithful all the way to the end. Amen? No matter what happens, they claimed, all of them said, they would be faithful, right?
Yep.
Mark chapter 14, look at this, verse 27 to 31. Mark 14, 27 to 31. So Jesus saith unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night, for it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. But Peter said unto him, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. And Jesus saith unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this day, even in this night, therefore the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. But he spake the more vehemently, if I should die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise also said they all.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. None of them were going to be outdone by Peter. You know, they're all going to just be right there and hang in there and do it all right and never fail and never give up and so on and so forth. But look at the end of this. John chapter 19, verse 25 through 27. John 19, verse 25 through 27. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother and his sister, Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, he saith unto his mother, woman, behold thy son. Then saith he to the disciple, behold thy mother. And from that hour that disciple took her unto his home. So what was it about John that led him to be the only disciple at the foot of the cross? So what did his start look like? We know what it ended like, but how did it start? How did it lead him to the end that he wanted? And what was it about Peter that ended up sabotaging him? Mm-hmm. After all, you know, both of them, John and Peter, loved Jesus, and both of them wanted to do the right thing.
Right.
So let's go back to John 13. And look at this again, verse 21 through 26. John 13, 21 to 26. Praise the Lord. When Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit, testified, and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, the one that shall betray me. Then the disciples looked one another, doubting of whom he spake. Then there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. That's John, right?
Yep.
Simon Peter, therefore, beckoned to him, said that he should ask who it should be of whom he spake. So he's asking, Peter is asking John to ask Jesus, who's the rat? Right? He then lying on Jesus' breast saith unto him, Lord, who is it? So then John asked him what Peter asked him to ask. And Jesus answered, it's to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Amen. Verse 27. And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then said Jesus unto him, that thou doest, do quickly. Amen. So let's look at this. What was it about John that led him to be the only disciple at the foot of the cross? What did his start look like? And how did it lead him to the end that he wanted? Amen.
Amen.
So you go back and Jesus says, someone in the room is going to betray me. And everybody starts to panic. They all start freaking out. Somebody's going to really blow it. And the truth is, I don't think any of them knew, is it me? You know, am I going to be the one that fails or what? So they're all freaking out, and they all want to know, and they're all starting to panic, and they look at each other. And then John really isn't doing anything. He's just sitting there leaning on Jesus. Everybody else is freaking out. Everybody else is trying to figure out, who is it? Is it me? Is it you? Is it this one? Is it that one? And But John's just, right? He's just leaning on Jesus. And then Peter does what most of us do. He's trying to figure out who's the bad guy. So he feels like he's got to do something. He has to find out who the traitor is. And then he has to fix it. Praise the Lord. Peter's active. Peter's striving. Peter's working. Peter's trying to get to the end, to the bottom of it. You know, he's going to figure this thing out. And that's exactly what happens in life. When we thrust ourselves into situations and we feel confused and frightened, and a lot of times we just react. We just want to get into the middle of it. And we trust in ourselves. And we believe that somehow we're going to do whatever it takes to fulfill God's commandments or God's desires or God's wants. And it's all about performance. It's all about us taking action and doing something as if we could do something. But who was at the foot of the cross? Who was there at the crucifixion? Just John. Amen?
Amen?
My point is that John understood what it meant to live in the love of Christ. The love of Jesus was his identity. He was the disciple whom Jesus loved. It wasn't like he was the only one. He was the only disciple that Jesus loved. That's just how he saw himself. That's how he defines himself. He sees himself as the one that Jesus loved.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Mark chapter 14, verse 29 through 31. I mentioned this before, but I'm just going back over to reestablish this. Peter said unto him, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. And Jesus said, verily I say unto you, this day, even the night before the cock crow twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. But he spake the more vehemently, if I should die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise also said they all. Mm-hmm. Amen. So just like Peter, all of the disciples made the same promise.
Yes.
Not me. I'll be there no matter what happens. Everybody else may bail, but not me. I'm going to be there. Everybody's saying the same thing. And that, by the way, includes John. He promised, and he failed. Because he wasn't there when they took him, when they captured him. He ran and hid just like everybody else did. Amen? But there's something about Jesus, amen, that John's relationship with went deeper than his promises and his performance. Praise God. This will help you if you can get it. Praise the Lord. It was something that enabled John to overcome his failures. And not only to overcome them, but to overcome them almost immediately, he was reconciled to God. He rushes back to Jesus when it counted the most.
Yes.
When he's otherwise all alone except for his mother and a couple of women.
Right.
He comes back. He shows up. It was love.
Yes.
It wasn't so much John's love for Jesus that drew him back. It was Jesus' love for John.
That's right.
Amen.
John's mind was more consumed with Jesus' love for him than his own love or lack thereof of Jesus.
Wow, that's good.
John filtered everything through God's love for him. I'm telling you, that's where we've got to be, church. There's no way my love for God is going to be a dominant thing every moment of every day of my life. But the love of God's love for me should dominate me, should be the motivation for me. Not my love, but his love. Amen. Problems couldn't stop John. Threats couldn't stop him. Condemnation, guilt, failure, none of it could stop him. Now, life is just plain not easy. I know that doesn't come as a revelation to any of you, but I'm just saying it. We face real problems, everybody, all of us. We want to fix things. We want to change things. We want to make things happen. But sometimes we forget to let God's love lead us. Our motives are not always based on the love of God, but our desires. Sometimes we think that what's most important to our success is how much effort we put into it. How much work we're willing to put into it. What kind of ability we have to be obedient to God. All of those things are great, but they're not enough to sustain us in life. The good news is the love of God is enough to sustain us.
Amen.
And more than enough. There's only one way to make things happen. The only way to make it over the long haul, over the length of our lives, is to do what seems so counterintuitive, and that is to lean on the love of Jesus.
Yes.
In spite of what we do or don't do, in spite of our failures, our successes, our fears, our anxiety, the thing that we can do is just to lean on the love of God and to lean in even harder the more challenged we are. We sit with Him, trust Him, and let love lead our lives. And I can promise you this, if you learn to do that, you will end well.
Hallelujah.
Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. I told you I'd be free. Just learn to trust in the love of God. Forget about your love for Him and focus on His love for you. And watch success happen as a result. Praise the Lord. You'll be where you need to be in the end if you'll be with Him from the beginning. Praise God.
Praise God.
Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate it. See you back here Sunday.
Amen.
Just walk in the love of God. Amen. God bless you.